Hi, and welcome to the breadboard and another TI Tuesday, where we look at various things each week from Texas Instruments, whether it be a chip, a board, software, or something else. This week, we're going to look at the booster pack called the C2000 TMS booster pack from Texas Instruments. And what this is a digital power booster pack. And to run it, you need to have a C2000 launch pad. To drive this, and it's one of the Insta spins from Texas Instruments, and we'll go into that in a little bit. But what I first want to do is describe what this board is. This is a basically buck regulator power control system without the actual buck regulator main control loops. And what we're going to do is have a quick look at how you can use the C2000 launch pad as the actual control system for this. All the hardware and software is built into the TMS320F28069 microcontroller from Texas Instruments. And with a bit of software, you can create a complete buck boost power solution. And what this launch pad and Boosterpack actually does is allow you to evaluate different solutions, changing parameters, performing frequency response analysis, changing the loads, etc., etc. And what we're having a look here right on this board is actually the Boosterpack itself. Now, the control circuitry is actually considerably, let's just say, small. You have on this blue connector the power coming in. Typically it'd be 9 to 12 volts in this specific design. You have a FET power driver IC, and there's also on the board a pair of FETs for driving this inductor, and that's pretty much it. The Vout is right here. Now these two larger heat sinks actually contain loads for the power regulator, the buck converter, so that you can actually set up either a 7.5 ohm fixed load, which is on all the time, or through a FET, you can actually pulse a 2 ohm load across the output of the buck converter as well. And so this is all under control of the launch pad. The launch pad is also providing all of the PWM, A to D conversion, D to A conversion for voltage references, and all of the programming loops in order to control the buck regulator as well. And the sample software that comes from Texas Instruments gives you the capability to try various algorithms, let's just say, and parameters within the control loop that would be able to suit your own design. So let's go have a look at the schematic. This is what is being provided on the board. We have a driver which takes the PWM outputs, and then it's a driver chip that allows you to drive N-channel MOSFETs very easily, and also provides on the high side a level converter for driving the MOSFET when it's got a higher voltage than what would normally be part of the control circuitry. Obviously, the lower side doesn't need that. We have our switching inductor. We have a current sense resistor with a op amp providing some gain and output back to two different analog to digital converters. And there's a bit of RC filtering going on both sides of this. We then have the output feeding out here to our load. And we also have a voltage sensing divider network on the output, also feeding back to the launch pad. With the kit, you get a TMS320F28069M launch pad. You get a USB cable. You need to provide your own 9-volt, 2-amp DC bench power supply. Now, you can use 12 volts as well. That's fine. It will just change the output readings you get slightly. So here's a block diagram. It's the same picture of the board. It's just got some areas highlighted to tell you what there is. So you've got the two headers where the booster pack connects with the launch pad. We have our 9-volt input. We have our current sensing circuitry here, which is basically just an op amp with a current sense resistor. and we have our buck converter here, this stage here. Now there's not a lot to this because really all it is a pair of MOSFETs which are actually under this little white device here, N1, and we'll see that in the circuit in a moment. We have this inductor sitting here and some smoothing capacitors, etc. We have these two devices here, which is our active load. This one is a MOSFET with a 2-ohm resistor, and this is a permanent 7-ohm resistor, which is put across the load. So if we go down and look at the schematic for this, you will see here MOSFET driver chip, the LM5109B. This has two inputs, a high side and a low side, and it is able to drive the two N-channel MOSFETs. And these N-channel MOSFETs, you notice there's no diode in this buck converter. The second MOSFET is acting as a fast synchronous diode. And so the two high drive and low drives go into this chip, and then the inputs to the chip come from the connector down here, which is being driven by the launch pad. On the out, you have a 30 milliohm resistor acting as our current sense, which is after the coil, a little bit of filtering into our differential amplifier, and then that is feeding out to our feedback, which goes into the two ADCs for the launch pad as well. And further on, we've got more smoothing. We have our divider network for voltage feedback to the launch pad, and then we have our two loads. So you can see here you've got the 7.5-ohm permanently connected load to ground, and you have a 2-ohm through this MOSFET also to ground. And that's pretty much all there is in this booster pack. It's very simple because all of the work is actually done by the C2000 launch pad. Now there's a lot of capabilities that this launch pad software combination along with this booster pack has, and I won't pretend to understand it all. So what I'm going to do is take you through what the software is going to do for us. We have a solution adapter which allows us to manipulate the various parameters and even input your own designs for the resistors, etc., etc., to test your own circuits if you have it connected. In this case, we have the fixed design of this booster pack. We have a compensation designer, which allows us to adjust the compensation factors and give us the basically loop control factors that would be fed into the software. We have a power stage that's control. Then we've got the control system, which is actually where the launch pad will be controlling the buck converter, etc. And then we also have in this suite of software that's for this a software frequency response analyzer, which is where under the control of the launch pad it will completely manipulate the some interference noise into the voltage reference of the buck boost convert circuitry and software, such that it will be able to analyze the frequency response and determine things like open loop gain and various other things, all under control of the launch pad. And all of this code is freely available for you to look at, and there are some excellent tutorials that I'm slowly working through that will help you learn all about how the TI C2000 launch pads will help you with your designs for your own power supply systems, and also if from an educational perspective teach you how buck converters work. There is a complete tutorial that takes you through how to test things and all about the algorithms and parameters to try and stuff like that. So what the software supports is basically three different types of builds that helps you go through the learning curve and design of your circuit. The first build is an open loop check. Basically, the launch pad is not getting in the way of providing feedback to the system. So all you've got is the pair of MOSFETs being driven by a PWM signal that you can manually change the duty cycle of. In build two, there is a closed voltage loop with full system functionality that has got the software frequency response analyzer built in. And the third build, which is the closed voltage loop check system functionality that doesn't have the software frequency response analyzer. So let's go look at the software under Code Composer Studio. So here we have Code Composer Studio, and this is where you can see where the Code Composer Studio GUI designer comes into play. It is actually rendering an image and configuration capabilities for the main.config file here. And you can actually look at the values of this if you want just by clicking on the CFG script. But what we want to do is look at it in the powerSUITE. Now, when you download Code Composer Studio from TI's website, you normally need to add additional modules to it in order to support things like this. And in this case, what we have to do is download the controlSUITE from Texas Instruments website. And I provide links to all of these so that you can get them. And when you download the suite, it automatically installs itself into Code Composer Studio. And the next time you start it, it will be available to you in the application. In order to load up this application, you would use View Resource Explorer, and you can then go into the controlSUITE that's already been loaded, go down into powerSUITE, into Development Kits, and out of the box, basically navigate down to the out-of-box demo, which is the BUCKCONV 28069M, which is the LaunchPad that we are using for this. And all you have to do is import the example project into Code Composer Studio, and that's pretty much it. After that, you can build it and debug the configuration, but once you've done the import, it will become available on this left-hand menu. So I'm just going to close this off here. If you open in this menu the configuration file, which is down near the bottom, this main.cfg, it will load up powerSUITE and show you the design of your circuit here, which is what we're playing with. And then below that, it's actually giving us the different builds that we're using. And if you remember when I showed you this before, you've got different choices. And here is the project options, and these are affecting the configuration. You've got the three different control systems. One is an open loop, which is really not a control system. You're just setting the PWM yourself. One is the closed loop with the software frequency response analyzer software built into it as well, so that you can do the SFRA. And the final one is closed loop without the SFRA. So let's take the first one, the open loop. And I've already actually changed the configuration of this one. Scroll down a little bit and you can see here. I've set the nominal value to 12 volts. Normally it is set to 9. I just happen to have a 12 volt power supply, not a 9 volt one here at the bench. And I've set the voltage out to be 2 volts, and I've set the I amps out limit or expectation to be 1.2 amps. All the other parameters are grayed out because they are based on using the launch pad. You can configure these yourself, but I'm not going to go into that right now. Suffice to say that everything is in the CFG script. You can actually look at this as a text file and pretty much modify everything if you want to. So once you've set the parameters, so I've told it I've got 12 volts coming in, I've got 2 volts that I want out, and I want up to 1.2 amps is what I'm going to be using. This allows it to configure the software, and the ADCs now know what to expect, and the DACs know what to output. And if you remember, we've got our voltage reference, which is effectively a digital to analog converter. It's using a comparator on the launch pad internally. And we've also got the feedback coming from the voltages here into an ADC, etc. Now, obviously, you can see a lot of these things are grayed out, but you can, in through your design, you can actually change a lot of these parameters. I have not done that for this example. It would take more than what's the scope of this intro of the board to do that. So I'll save that for another day. These are other options for loading up the software frequency response analyzer, which we'll have a look at as well, and the compensation designer. So let's compile the application. So just right click on the project and click on build. If this is the very first time that you are building the project, then it will take a little longer than it just did here. Once you've built the project, you just have to hit run. Now, this is assuming that you have your launchpad plugged into your computer and it's recognized it. Now, very quickly, if you go into device manager of your computer, and you should see, in my case, it's this one, USB COM port 4. I only had two COM ports, 5 and 6, which were from other devices that are plugged into my computer. and there are some USB devices that show up which are based on the launch pad as well, and that is the TIXDS100 channel A and TIXDS channel B. If you don't see the COM port showing up, go into channel B and advanced options and make sure you click on load VCP, which is the virtual COM port. Just click OK. You may have to reboot, but I didn't. So that's all you need to do to be able to get that COM port up and running. Now, in this case, I already have it up and running. It's not going to have any effect on our initial run of the application. So all the instructions to run this project and go through the tutorials are in this PDF. So this is the one we're going to do right now, which is what we were looking at before. Here's all the software setup. Tells you all the things you need to do. Navigate to controlSUITE using English, unless you're not English. I think there's a Chinese version as well, but anyway, I'm using the English one. Going to powerSUITE, etc., etc. And I've done all that now, and I've set up my options. So we're down here where we've got another picture, which is the one that's on the Code Composer Studio. We've got the parameter set up here. Now, the only difference is mine says 12 volts for the VIN. And then it tells you just clean the project, build all, and be careful. If you've got a lot of projects loaded, build all will build all of them. My preference is to right-click on the specific project and just tell it to build that one. In the debug environment, you can load up all of the watch items in the expressions by running a script that is provided, and it's called addWatchWindowVars.js from the project directory. So you use the scripting console open file command to open the addWatchVars.js file, and that is found at the bottom on the scripting console. And you can just put in the command here. You've got a file open over this right-hand side. You can load up the script. All right, so the scripts are located under control TI, or your wherever you've installed controlSUITE to, which the default will be C:TI, controlSUITE, powerSUITE, V1.0, bus boot convert, boost XL buck converter, buck VMC. So go into the project folder and you should see the add watch window vars.js. When you run that, it will add all of these watch items. Now, to activate them, though, you click on the enable silicon real-time mode. You just say yes to this if you get prompted. So we just say yes. Over on the right-hand side, we're going to make sure the continuous refresh is turned on. And then all you need to do now is click on run for your application. Now, we're in open loop mode, which means that, as you can see here, there's no duty cycle going on. These are watching certain parameters of the application. And the first one is the actual duty cycle that's being output by the PWM. And when you're in open loop, you can control it by changing the set point duty cycle here. Now, on the booster board, there is a switch that you need to turn on. So let me just show you a picture of that. Right, this switch here, right here on to the left of this image, it would be off, and to the right, it is turned on. Right now on my board, it is turned off. So I'm going to turn it on, and what you'll see is really not a lot happening right now. So I've turned now on, there's nothing coming out. So now this duty set one, if I go in here and change it as per the instructions to 0.3, it should give us out. Typically, if you had a 9 volt in, it would give you the 2 volts or 2.2 volts out. In our case, because I'm feeding with 12 volts in, I'm getting about 3.2 volts out. And you can see here it's reading it in real time. That's the actual output voltage. And if I put my DVM on here, which I happen to have here, I'm not going to put it up on screen to show you, but I will measure it just to read it out to you. And just to confirm, I'm actually getting exactly 3.332 volts. So 3.332, it aligns with my Agilent U1272 exactly. So that's good. And I can just adjust this. This is the duty cycle. So I can change this to say, if I changed it to be 0.6, it's going to increase that. No, I don't want to go to 0.6, but let's just go to 0.6. 5 maybe, it's going to increase this output voltage, because remember, alright, so it's gone up to 5 volts. I'm feeding 12 in, and I'm about 50% duty cycle, so basically I've got roughly 5 volts coming out. If I go down to, say, 10%, it's going to go much lower, and it's working out quite a reasonable approximation as the pulse width modulation versus the actual output voltage. But that's just coincidence. So that's the first test. Now what you can also do is turn the load on. The 7 ohm load is already on, but if you click on the active LD1, so the active load, this is the MOSFET that is driving the 2 ohm resistor. So if you put a 1 in here, and this is in real time, and press enter, you will now see on your board there is a light. Let me see if I can find a bigger picture of the board here, right here. So on the board, roughly here, there is a light, this LD2. This indicates the MOSFET being turned on and off. And you should see it just flickering. I think it's running at maybe 10 or 100 hertz or something like that. Anyway, you can just see it just slightly shimmering. Now what we're going to do is we're actually going to turn it completely on for this test, because we're going to run the software frequency response analyzer in a moment. And so what we do is we then go to this next one, which is continuous on, and we put a 1 in there, and it will then make that LED go on solid. Now you will find now that the current has gone up quite considerably. Actually, let me just put this back to 0.3, and you'll see here that the output current now is gone up to 1.5 amps. This is actually amps. This is a current limit here set for 6 amps. Now, as you can see, we've got 12 volts going in. We've got basically 3 volts coming out. So 3 volts into 2 ohms is going to give us about 1.5 amps. Now, this is 2 ohms in parallel with 7.5 ohms, so it's actually slightly less than 7. Slightly less than 2 ohms. If I change the current trip set, all of these parameters you can change in real time, and it sends them out to the LaunchPad registers. If I change this down to, say, 1 amp, it will actually trip this from working. But I don't want to do that right now, because I want to show you the software frequency response analyzer working. And what this is an application that's included that will allow us to measure the response of the system in open loop mode to help you figure out what you're going to, or whether your circuit components and things are the correct selections. So if you haven't connected this at all, you just hit setup connection, pick the required COM port, and just say okay. In my case, it's COM4. Make sure you have the boot on connect unchecked. Just say okay, and then you click on connect, and now you should get a green light down here, or a green little box, and you'll get some settings come up here. So we've got an injection amplitude of 0.005, and I think that's volts, so that's 0.00, so that's like a 5 millivolt. Steps per decade is 35, and I don't know everything that's happening here and the full impact. I'm still learning this. So you can just click on start the sweep. It's doing a fixed point math in this particular case, and it will run through, and it's doing a frequency response analysis of the board with the current components and the current parameters that were set over here. Just takes a few seconds to run. So you can see all the time that it's running, all these parameters up here are changing as it's adjusting its parameters and its frequency and things like that for this frequency response analyzer. You can see its start frequency is 100 hertz, and it's going up to a maximum frequency of 67 kilohertz of noise that it's injecting. And it provides you some nice bode plots that you can use to then analyze the response of your circuit. And this is the one which is from the booster pack and C2000 launch pad that I have here. You can change these parameters if you want to for different starting frequencies, the steps per decade, etc., etc. Oh, and you've got two different modes of operation too. All of this is described in the user guide and the PDF that I just showed you. So that's one of the nice little built-in tools that are available for the LaunchPad and BoosterPack. Now, the next thing I'm going to do is change this to be a closed voltage loop. As you saw, this is still running right now. As you can see here, I have to manually change these parameters. If I turn off the load, the heat sinks are actually getting quite warm right now. If I turn these back to zeros to turn the higher load off, you'll see that the current has come right down here to 0.3 amps. And the output voltage is sitting at 3.3. Now, if I turn the load back on again, you can see here that the output voltage has dropped to 3.1 from 3.3, well, almost 3.2. And if I put it on continuously, you'll see that it drops to roughly 3 volts. That's because there's no compensation on the PWM output. It's still sitting there at 0.3. So the way you can do that is, of course, now I could increase this to, say, 0.4, maybe. That might, you know, just guessing to bring that. And that took it up to 4 volts, so that's no good. So I'm doing manually what the software would normally be doing automatically under interrupts and under program control. So I go back to 0.3 for the moment for that. And you can see it's I'm not getting the right voltage, so probably 0.35 or something. Let's try 3.4. Yeah, that's close. But you want this to all be running under automation. So now I've changed this to say closed voltage loop, and it's got the SFRA in it still. And if I stop the application and then I recompile, it's going to ask me about saving the config because I changed that. I say yes. And then I let it compile and upload. I start my debugging. Watch Windows again, real time. Click on run. And there's one thing I just forgot before I run the software, the switch that's on the board. The way the software is written, if it drops straight through the loop or if the power's already on, it doesn't go through its stages. I think this is a bit of a protection mechanism that they've built in. So you need to start the software from the power input to the board being turned off. That's not the power to the launch pad. That's the power to the actual booster board, the 9 volts or the 12 volts. All right, so let's just do this again very quickly. Now we'll hit run. So you can see the top one every now and again is trying to see if it can get any output going on, and it's not. So now I'm going to switch the switch to bring in the load. And the output now has gone up to 2 volts, as you can see there. And it's got a pulse width modulation of about 1.8. Now, there's no load going on here. But if I actually turn these back on again, you can see that the PWM has changed, the duty cycle. And the volts, though, is still being kept at 2 volts. Now, if I want the voltage to be, say, 4 volts, I can just change this now in here. And it will actually ramp up now to 4 volts. And you can see the pulse width modulation is adjusting as well. Our current is now sitting at 1.8 amps. Now, this has a comparator built into the current sensing that's part of the launch pad. It's actually not in the schematics, and I showed you that before. But if I change the trip setting, so right now it's set for 6 amps. If I change this to, say, 1 amp, because that is below the threshold of this, it will actually go into a fault condition, which is indicated by the fault flag, and the fact that the output, the duty cycle, sorry, where is it there? The output volts is now gone to 0, even though the duty cycle, the last value was at 0.8999. It's basically stopped driving the board. Okay, to clear it now, I just had a quick check. You have to set the output voltage to 0 volts, clear the fault, and then change the output voltage back to something that you want. So in here, this is still running. What I have to do is let's increase this current as well back up to 6 amps, of course. We set the desired output volts, which I've got here, we set to zero. Clear the fault, which it already is. I did that before. And then you can turn the output on again, which is now on. And now you can actually program back in a set point voltage that you want. So let's just say 3 volts. And the output now will ramp up there to 3 volts. So we're back in operation again. Sorry, I just didn't quite remember the reset sequence for the board. And that's pretty much it. So you can see here now with a closed loop, you can actually still play with all the different parameters. Now there's lots of test points on the board too that you can hook up an oscilloscope and things like that. And you know, as right here, we're watching all of these watch windows. Now you can also do some graphing with this too. You just go into Tools, Graph, Single Time, set up some parameters. So the parameters we want to use are 400 buffer, data size 400, 16-bit unsigned, and 12 is the queue.
So 400. 16 unsigned. Buffer size 400. DB UFF1. Shell address. DB UFF1.
And we click OK. So there we have the graph down the bottom here now that has just been collected. So this is the output volts over time. So very, very quickly collected. All nice and sweet. And you can read all about that. Again, I'm just reading straight out of the manual here that comes with the board that you can download from TI. And there are more examples in here. It's a very comprehensive workbook. And there's also lots of information on the SFRA and the board as well. More information, schematics, et cetera, theory of operation, as well as the chips that are on board. And there's lots of information in PDF format for the the C2000 launch pad as well. Teaching you all about it. So in summary, I don't want to belabor this, it's already going on a bit too long. The C2000 DPS booster pack is an excellent little tool for people wanting to learn about buck regulators and things like that. The software that there is for the C2000 launch pad also allows you to very quickly build your own circuits and integrate them as well. Obviously, you'd have to put them on a PCB or breadboard or something like that, but you can see that there's very, very little to the actual buck boost converter. All it comprises of is the inductor, the current sensing, and the MOSFET drivers. That's pretty much it outside of your load. So it would be very easy to build up various different designs for using higher frequencies, which means smaller inductors, more power, maybe higher voltage ones, etc., etc. And you just have to provide all the parameters into the software here to allow you to be able to play with it and test it. So it's an excellent little board. I think that I will be playing with it in the future for other things as well. And the CC2000 launch pads, I keep saying CC, it's just C2000 launch pads, are also fully capable of driving stepper motors and various other things. They have full motor control capabilities and things too. And I will be looking at a motor control board with one of these in the future. Now, on the theme of buck regulators, I don't know how many of you have looked in the past, but a lot of the LED power supplies that are out there for constant current or dimmed ones and things like that actually use pretty much an exact same method of control as these buck controllers use. The only difference is that there is an LED string in the load and you are working the buck regulator in a constant current through the load mode instead of maintaining a constant voltage. And you just use the current sensing as their input to the ADCs in order to be able to control that. And that's another example that I'm going to be showing you in a future TI Tuesday as well. I've got a slightly different controller that I need to use for that one, only because the software has been built for a different one in the example software. And so when I get that, I will show you it. Anyway, for now, I don't know. I've gone through this board. It's very interesting. It's a really nice set of software that Texas Instruments has set up to allow you to monitor and configure the C2000 with the Buck Boosterpack, and I'm quite impressed with the overall result. The way that they're doing the current load variations and things like that, as well as the overall design, it's definitely worth a look through the code as well as the PDFs to see how it all works. Anyway, that's it for this one. I will provide the links, etc., etc., and I will see you on the next TI Tuesday.